Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to the last game of Ostende 1906 legendary tournament. And this time I would like to show you the game where Akiba Rubinstein play the most important game of the tournament. He's gonna play as white, and his opponent, very strong opponent, Carl Schlechter. The strongest Austrian player, and he's gonna play as black. He's ranking at that time, according to the chess metrics, 2756. That means number 3 in the world. And if you remember, Akiba Rubinstein was about number 15 in the world already. However, this was his first like huge Western tournament with a lot of famous players involved. 42 years old, Carl Schlechter, however, in peak of his career, and 4 years later, Carl Schlechter actually could become the world champion. He played with Emmanuel Lasker, and after 9 games out of 10 contracted games, Carl Schlechter was leading by 1 point. So this was just awesome. And in last game, he was winning. He had the winning position. However, he blundered to the completely drawn position, and then he blundered again, and then he lost. So the match ended tied 5-5. Both players won one of the games, the rest were drawn, and Emmanuel Lasker retained his title. So this is how strong Carl Schlechter was. So without further ado, let's see what happened over the board. We have d4 by Akiba Rubinstein, d5, and now Akiba goes for the London system, bishop on f4. So I think that was, you know, quite a fashionable opening at that time, because we've seen Akiba played a couple of times in the West against the London system, and he tried this as white as well from time to time. So but it happened, you know, for the first time in this tournament. We have e6, e3, and bishop on d6. So very early challenging the bishop. We have bishop on g3, knight on f6, knight on d2. And here nowadays what black play usually is the castle or c5. This is of course possible. b6 system with the bishop on b7 is also possible. However, here Schlechter immediately goes for bishop takes on g3. Is not such a popular nowadays, as it's too early a bit to open the h file. And black of course gonna castle on the queen side, so white can prepare. And now we have queen on e7, preparing e5. So Akiba Rubinstein immediately plays f4, preventing that. And now, of course, e4 is quite weak, as both d and f pawns advance already. So knight on e4. And this is definitely the monster knight. Watching, and g3 actually is a very serious threat. So Rubinstein immediately just exchanged the knights. We have d takes on e4. And queen on d2, preparing for the castle as well. Knight on d7, and now g4, taking under control f5 square, so this pawn can be attacked much easier. We have knight on b6, Carl Schlechter is ready for that, because after bishop on d2, he plays bishop on d7, and the bishop is ready to actually defend the pawn if needed. We have knight on h3 first, before castle, because now this knight can go to g5 and double attack on the h7, as this is semi-open h-file, and also the pawn. So definitely f6 is the good move from Carl Schlechter, and now knight on f2, attacking the pawn, bishop on c6, just on time, and now c4. Very active gameplay by Akiba Rubinstein, and his position already is pretty good. We have castle by Schlechter, castle by Rubinstein, and now h6, as the pawn is defended by the rook, but you know, rook want to move somewhere to the center, and it's now it cannot be attacked easily. We have queen on c2, now attacking the pawn twice, and now f5, defending. Queen on c3, and king on b8, going with the king to the safer position. G takes on f5, e takes on f5, and now g4, putting pressure on f5. And now how to react as black? If black plays something like g6, is not really great. Simply g takes on f5, g takes on f5, rook d on g1. This pawn gonna be pretty weak, and probably white gonna take this pawn and win the game, because there are no complications here and black has quite passive position. So Schlechter tries to complicate it a bit and plays bishop on d7. We have rook d on g1. And now g5, and here all the complications starts. How to react for that? For example, if g takes on f5, black actually don't need to take with the bishop, can take with this pawn on f4 first, and after e takes on f4, bishop f5, and now black has a very nice blocker, so this pawn cannot move anywhere, has already two passed pawns, and they are weak passed pawns, however there are two of them. So Schlechter would have very nice counterplay here. So of course d5 is possible, but look at this knight. This knight can enter the game, maybe even in the future jump to d3, and white still have maybe not better position, but you know, the game is would be very, very complicated. In this position, Lasker, who actually wrote about that game in his magazine, he said f takes on g5. This should be played because it's simplified the position. Black doesn't have much choice here. H takes on g5 and then simply take it. And now white actually can play against this pawn. And look at this. G4 is already controlled 3 times, so definitely it's very easy to block and then win this pawn. Could be the matter of time, as black would have no counterplay, you know, anywhere on the board. So this was possible. However, Rubinstein goes for knight on h3. Not really the greatest move, because now we have f takes on g4, and all of this is forced. Bishop on g4, bishop on g4. Rook takes on g4, and now queen e6, attacking the rook and attacking also the pawn for the you know, two times. But Rubinstein thought, okay, I can handle that, and actually he plays rook h on g1, so he gives this pawn because he calculated that he gonna win the pawn back, and he would be quite right, because after queen on c4, queen on c4, knight on c4, this was played in the game. He played f takes on g5, so all is good. And after h takes on g5, he could actually, as Lasker, you know, analyze this game, go for the knight takes on g5. Of course, this pawn is without protection now. However, knight on g5, knight e3, and rook on e4, attacking the knight, and also there is a threat on the board, so black would probably play something like rook on e8, and after exchanging, the game could continue. Yes, white have this weakness, however it's not easy to actually win that game, so probably that would be a draw. So Rubinstein plays something else. Rook moves from the fourth rank to g3. And now, of course, we have g4 immediately, as the pawn cannot be taken because the rook defends the knight. So knight is, you know, under attack. So we have knight on f2. Everything looks pretty good. You know, the pawns are under attack. So black gonna get the pawn back. We have rook on h2. So black improves the position of the rook greatly, and here actually Rubinstein should, this was his last chance, knight on g4, and yes, he gonna lose this pawn. However, after knight on e5, attacking the defender of the rook, probably we would have something like rook on b4, and after, let's say, rook on g8, pinning that rook, king on c8, knight on c4, rook on c4, king on b2, and this probably is also a draw. Maybe black are slightly better, but it would be very difficult to defend that pawn. So But probably white would defend, so that was the last chance. However, Rubinstein calculated differently. Knight on d1, another passive move, and this actually looks like very, very solid move, because defending b2, defending e3, and now preparing for g4, so everything looks pretty, pretty good. But this is also the critical position of the game, because Lasker, about next move, he wrote a charming and attack out of nothing. So what did Schlechter do in this position? Feel free to pause the video and find the winning continuation for Black while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? So very strong move is c5, and now what white can do. Now let's see what are the possibilities. So for example, the rook on g4, this is of course the what would you like to play. The problem is this continuation, c takes on d4, rook on e4, and everything looks pretty good for white. However, rook c8, this is extremely strong. And now after rook on d4, knight a3 with check, discovered check, so knight on c3. Now rook on c2, you see already how strong attack it is. So a king on d1, and now rook on b2, knight is under attack, so knight on e2, rook c on c2, and this is just winning for black. So not this way, it's impossible to continue. Also, Lasker wrote that d takes on c5 isn't that great, because black can actually double the rooks on the second file. However, he didn't wrote all the continuation. However, let's check what would happen, because this is very interesting. It's not winning because white actually could have a very good chances here for draw, for sure, maybe even for win. Rook d on d2 is really bad, because now rook on g4, look at this. How can you proceed now? This is very complicated position. You cannot just take on b2, okay? And you don't have any other moves, as this knight, you know, controls everything, and white gonna, you know, harass your king on the 8th and 7th rank. If you try to take it, knight on b2, the problem is rook on g8, and you gonna actually lose that, because king on c6, now rook on c8, and king has to move here or here. Doesn't really matter, because this rook comes and, you know, win the rook or the knight, so doesn't really matter. Probably this is better, but still, rook on b7, king on a6, winning the material, and black would have no choice, would have to play the only trick here, rook on d1, okay, and after king on d1, win here, and after c6, white stands slightly better. Probably that would be a draw, but white still have some chances maybe to win, but probably that would be a draw. So this is definitely not the way to go. So probably what Lasker meant, it was first knight on e5, defend this pawn, and remaneuver the knight maybe to d3. That's a very, very serious threat. So probably king on b1, and only now, you know, double the rooks, and this is completely crushing for black. So let's say a3. Now knight on f3 even can continue to attack on the king's position, but also can just exchange couple of pieces and get the winning position. For example, rook on f1. Now just exchange this rook on g2, rook on g2, rook h1, and this pawn gonna win the game. So as you see, this is also not possible. D takes on c5 is losing, taking on g4 is losing. What else can play? Rubinstein try move the rook to control the second file, okay? So this was his move. However, now black has forced to win. So I hope you see that already. If not, you can actually pause the video one more time and try to find the winning continuation for black while I enjoy my cup of tea again. Okay, everything is forced here. So simply, rook takes on g2. Okay, rook takes on g2. C takes on d4. E takes on d4. rook on d4, and this is completely winning. This was played by Schlechter and Rubinstein, and here Rubinstein blunder. He played rook on g4, however, there is no way he can save that game. Knight on c3, just simply knight on e5, defend that pawn, and these two pawns gonna just win the game. So, not possible. Rook on g4 was played, and after rook on d1, we don't have the continuation. The rest of the game is unavailable, but I believe Rubinstein just resigned in this position, because of course if the king takes the rook, then black gonna win this game. And look at this, one extra pawn, but also all these squares are controlled by black, and white cannot take that pawn, cannot take the knight, of course, and this would be losing. However, in this position, you know, the rest of the game is unavailable. So this was the game between Akiba Rubinstein, 23 years old, and this was his great tournament. I would like to show you the last table, the final scores, what just happened after the fifth stage. So here we go. We have Carl Schlechter, who was the winner. If Rubinstein wins that game, then he would have 20 points, the same like Schlechter and Marozzi, but he lost and he got the third place. Schlechter, he needed just a draw here to win the tournament, and it doesn't really matter. Maybe this is why Rubinstein tried to play for the win in completely, you know, drawn position. I have no idea. We have only, you know, the game and some comments from Emmanuel Lasker in his magazine, and that's all. And as you see, Bernstein was fourth, Teichmann, Richard Teichmann, Frank Marshall, seventh place. He got to the final, you know, nine players, Janowski and Perlis as well. So a lot of great players here, and Rubinstein, Bernstein, you know, Perlis did pretty well, and they started to be really recognized in the West as the very, very strong players. So after Ostende, definitely Rubinstein career, you know, started to run much faster. If you like this video and saga, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss another games from Rubinstein saga, but also the newest 2020 tournaments, the new one are coming, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.